Hey everybody, it is Friday, August 28th, and this is actually my final America's Next Top Model, Jay's Chat, Cycle 18, and I'm just waiting for our winner, Sophie, to join. I read all your questions. There's so many of you that said, no, why can't you continue Jay's Chat? I have actually decided that I am going to do an additional fans only, that's for you guys, a chat from all the cycles where I'm actually gonna connect with a new Uber fan, Oliver, first, and then I'm gonna connect with all of you live. So I'm gonna go live screen and screen with all of you fans. I'm gonna answer your questions and I will announce that date next week, so you'll know when that's gonna happen. I'm just waiting for Sophie to join. Let me just check if she's there. There she is. Let me add. So we're just waiting for Sophie. It's just connecting. But yes, this is going to be a fun chat today. So much tea to spill. Sophie!
Oh my God!
How are you?
This is so fun! Hi!
I'm just adjusting my camera there so I can see you better. Yes! How gorgeous are you? You look exactly the same as the day you won America's Next Top Model back in... Technically, it was 2011. That's what people don't know.
Yeah, I was like, I've been rewatching it. I actually rewatched it last night for the first time. I watched it once when it aired, and then I had so much traumatic stress from watching it that I just rewatched it last night. It's so funny. And I was like, that's almost 10 years ago. And then I get all these comments on Instagram like, oh, you know, I'm getting old. It's been 10 years. And I'm like, Oh, yeah, it has.
You know, there were so many questions. I was going through them this morning on your page and my page. And I do. The reason I did this Jay's Chat is really for all the fans. And I know people have really been dipping into that nostalgia and rewatching all the cycles of America's Next Top Model. And I have tons of questions pulled. We're going to try to get through all of them.
I'm so happy. Yay!
Michael's on here from Slutty Puffin. Hilarious account. I love it. And he says...
Slutty Puffin.
Oh, yeah, his name's Michael. But he's like, two of my faves. I love him. His account is hilarious. You guys got to follow him. But first, I gotta admit something to you, Sophie, that don't know. She's like, oh, God. Of all the cycles, and I absolutely have kind of my favorite girls throughout all the cycles... this cycle was bittersweet in many ways for me. I knew it was going to be my last cycle of the show. I couldn't talk about it contractually at the time, but the cast of you girls, I just want to read everyone's names: Simone, Kyle, Sophie, Laura, Catherine, Candace, Mariah, Asmarie, Ebony, Louise, Alicia, Annalise, Ashley, and Jasmina, like all of you girls. Of all the casts, and I mean this 100% with all sincerity.
I don't know where you're going with this. I'm just like...
I want to say this. I felt like you guys were the group I wanted to hang with. I wanted to be friends with, but I was in this position where I was working, and you guys were the cool group. I don't know why. I just... felt so connected to kind of all of you. And I know even Simone, I remember there was that moment where I was talking with her, you know, backstage at Toronto Fashion Week. And I really meant what I said in that moment. I was like, girl, you're gorgeous. And like, look at where the plus size market has grown to. Imagine Simone, like it was a situation where it's such a difficult pressure cooker for so many of you to kind of be in and you're young. But I just wanted to start off and say, I loved you guys all, like in a way that I felt like I wanted to be friends with all of you. That was the cool thing for me.
That's really nice. I'm already emotional watching it back, but that's so sweet. You know, it's really funny watching it back. I was so filled with like love and cuddles. This sounds really weird, but like love and cuddles, like last night and this morning watching it. And I was like, holy shit,
we can swear. It's Instagram Live. Holy shit, yeah.
Holy shit, this was really like an awesome group of people. And there really wasn't that much conflict. Aside from kind of obviously some stuff that got brought up, but it really is a really good group. And I regrettably have to say, like, Annalise, who's here, yay!
I saw the comments from Annalise. Like, I live for her. Like,
so
live
great.
For her and her energy. And, you know, I spend a lot of my time well, I have before the pandemic, flying back and forth to the UK a lot for work. I love being in London. I love the UK. I love, like, Annalise, like, I've seen her. She doesn't even realize I've seen her on different things. I'm like, you go, girl. I live for her.
She is always the most supportive, positive little ray of sunshine. And absolutely. So she's also doing these on YouTube, I think. She's doing some catch-up. I had to watch some of them because I was like, what happened?
Yes, Annalise is doing her recaps on YouTube. You absolutely have to check it out because she is spilling tea too, which I love. And encourage, like, everybody has a story to tell. We all should be able to speak our truths. And that's really, you know, what this whole Jade chat is about. But there are tons of questions. Let's dive in. There's just so many. A lot of them are the same. So I was just like picking and choosing different people. But BMore_2012 said, why did they basically have British all-stars versus American newcomers? And Sophie, I already saw you answered him and said, this is a good point. Dive into it. What were your thoughts?
You know, also, thank you again for saying that, Mr. J. That was really nice.
I meant it, honestly.
You know, it's really funny. We didn't know. So I was in London and I was modeling with Store Models at the time. And I'd finished Britain's Next Top Model. That was a real mess, to be honest. Like, I had no idea what I was doing. So no idea what's going on. And I get this call from America's Next Top Model producers. And in my head, I was like, oh, they just want me to be the next Tyra.
Oh, I love it. She was like, I went high in my mind.
I like...
exactly. Envision what you want to see for yourself.
Oh, yeah, girl, so I love awful. It. My ego was like, yeah, okay, cool. Anyway, they asked to be a contestant. And I was like, man, this sounds awful to say, but I was like, I don't know. Like, Britain's was really hard and rough. And there was a lot of cattiness. And I just don't know if I'm up for it. Anyway, lo and behold, I say yes. And I'm on a plane to California, right? I think I've been like once in my life when I was tiny, had no idea what I was doing. And I don't know if anyone said this, but did anybody ever talk about the word ice?
We've talked about it in past chats. So okay. Yeah, so being put on ice, you mean?
Yeah, so being put on ice means so you can't talk.
You can't talk. So basically, for those who have not heard this term before, producers would hush at the girls if they didn't have a mic pack on or cameras weren't rolling. They would say, you're on ice, you're on ice. Which means you cannot speak. You were only allowed to speak when cameras were rolling and you had mics on. But continue. Yeah.
No. So we had no idea. I had no idea there were other Brits. They tell you nothing. I cannot.
Oh, you didn't know there were other girls from the previous Britain's Next Top Model? You didn't know that?
No idea. Until I got on
the plane. I didn't know that.
Yeah. And I saw Annalise in the car and I was like, Annalise, that's amazing. Like, oh my God. And I went to go like say, I think somebody must have collected us from airport arrival or something, and I get in this car and Annalise's there and I'm like, yay! And they're like, ice, you can't talk. And so it was the weirdest thing. And then the next minute we're in a hotel in Universal for a week where, I don't know if anyone said, but where you can't talk to anyone, you didn't have your phone, you didn't leave, and the windows didn't open. So it was like...
Yeah, it's like literally going into a little bit of form, like quarantine, but even worse, no cell phone, no internet.
You had no idea when you were going to leave. So one day we went on a road trip to the Grove and we went shopping. I remember that. Like, and you do psych tests and medical tests and it's really hardcore. And I remember just thinking, this is so different to Britain's Next Top Model. And I kind of saw some other girls from other seasons of Britain, but hand on heart, I don't know why we had done it before and the Americans hadn't.
That was one of the other questions from CL Barden said, I love Sophie from the beginning. So she gave you some love. But how was her experience different from America's Next Top Model than Britain's Top Model? And how was it? Well, she also asked how you were recruited, which you just said. But do you think there was an unfair advantage? I think this was a shock to viewers as well. All the Brits had been on Britain's Next Top Model and all the Yanks were newbies. Did you think that was unfair?
No, I think it totally messed up the Brits. I think we all had this post-traumatic stress. I think we all, it was really interesting. Like when we did photo shoots at the beginning, you saw for the first 7 episodes, the Americans killed it. And it looks like the Brits are just having a complete mental breakdown. And I think what happened was like, we'd been through it. So we were like, oh, we kind of got this. And yet the production value was so different. Like in America's Next Top Model, you weren't allowed to talk to the crew. In Britain's, you used to sit down with them for dinner. Like Britain's was very free. And like, America's, it was a machine.
It was a machine because in the beginning, girls would talk to crew. Like, it was very loosey-goosey early on.
Oh.
And we're going to talk about it this chat, guys. There's lots of tea to spill. Yes, the show had become a machine, and there are a lot of questions asking, so I'll ask the questions. But behind the scenes, you were saying there was conflict in front of the camera, but not that much. But let me tell you guys, behind the scenes, the toxicity, the back-talking, the backstabbing, certain producers, what producers would say about talent, how they created these divides. I'm not even going to mention names. And I'll say, even though I know it was my last cycle, there were a lot of producers who up and left. Even one of the co-executive producers was like, I'm done. There were wars behind the scenes. People left this show. The show behind the scenes had turned into, remember, this energy is a top-down thing. And let me tell you, it stemmed at the top, and it was just an awful silo of negativity, and no one wanted to be a part of that really anymore.
Is this happened on our cycle?
Your cycle, yeah.
Okay.
We'll get to the questions, girl. I'll tell you.
Oh my God, this is so exciting. This is like, so I always thought that Tyra was really absent in our cycle. And I didn't feel like she wanted to be a part of our cycle. And we didn't actually see her until quite far in to do like one-on-one things. And when it was very fleeting. And I just really didn't think, I thought she was just like done. Maybe there was stuff in her personal life, but I really didn't feel like she wanted us almost.
Well, it was like a check-in kind of moment. But again, I'll speak to how that kind of cyclone of negativity. So, I mean, it was a top-down thing. And there were several executive producers. I'm speaking about one who...
Does his name rhyme with Ben?
I'm not going to say. But I will say this. This was a person who is instrumental in being divisive in a calculating way, not only just with contestants, but with everyone behind the scenes. This is a person who goes here, goes there. Kelly Catrone was new. We'd have several new judges over the cycles, right? No issues integrating them in. But this was a person who would go to, okay, Kelly, you're going to be the da-da-da. You're going to be a this. Now don't, yeah, no, so-and-so is like this. Avoid Miss J. She's like that. Mr. J is like that. Nigel's going to be like that. He was very divisive. And to this day is that person. Look, I'm not here to like bash or drag people, but all I'll say, if anyone does figure out who I'm talking about, look at his history. Go find other producers, people he's worked with. Try and find positive stories. That's all I'm going to say. Find positive stories, because in our world, I've worked in the world of entertainment, and sure, there are things that happen behind the scenes. People don't get along, this and that, but we're all adults. We know how to work through things. And I've worked on E, and so I've worked on several different shows. I've never experienced the toxicity that existed behind the scenes. And it came from a few people at the top. And then what do you expect when that's coming down? You create a pyramid of chaos, and you need to own up to what you created and how that affected everyone on a psychological level. And I mean everyone, producers, talent, the girls. It's not fair, and it wasn't healthy.
But and that you really felt that happened on cycle 18?
Oh, I think people, it was the tipping point. We'd already spilled over. I mean, like I said, I only negotiated my last two cycles of 17, 18. It was just like, I spoke, and I'm still close with a lot of producers on the show. It created such a weird fear culture, never experienced it anywhere else. Not recently, but for years after, I had like a PTSD kind of effect from it. Like, you know, when certain people from the show who I do not keep in contact now would try and call me or reach out, you have this anxiety, and I'm not a person who deals with anxiety disorder. And I just realized like I need to do my own kind of, you know, get to a place where I'm healthy, and I don't want anything really to kind of do with that culture.
Yeah, I don't understand why it all came to, getting like really real here, to be honest, were they desperate for ratings? Like why did
I think that definitely had happened early on. I mean, the ratings were falling. They tried to do the high fashion cycles. Everything was a change. Like look at with this cycle, you know, I think it was like throwing fucking spaghetti on the wall to try and make something work. Like think about it, the theme song, fans were you're horrified. What happened to the famous theme song? It turned into this punk rock mashup. Can anyone even sing the theme song to this Cycle 18? Nobody. You know, you don't do that to fans, right?
If I had to hear the word pot leader one more time, I was like, what is this word I'm saying?
I know. So, but let's dive. I love everyone saying down here, like, ooh, this is the real tea. We are going to speak the real tea. You know, this is the last American Cycle I'm going to do. Again, a lot of people have asked if I would do Canada's Next Top Model because I was the host and exec producer on that. I'm thinking about that. But I am going to do a big fan episode where I connect with all the fans.
I'll be there. I love this. I'm literally hearing this all for the first time. And actually, it makes me really happy because I'm not joking. Like, afterwards, it messed with me a bit. It messed with me. And it was toxic. And you couldn't put your finger on it because the girls weren't bad. But the energy, and I'm like a big one for energy. The energy was wrong. And I'm so glad you said that it wasn't just me thinking. And also, I spent that whole, being deadly serious, I spent that whole cycle thinking that Miss J hated me. I don't know if anything was going on with her in production.
Well, I can speak for Miss J. I don't want to take words that and his thoughts, but I'm going to speak to what I experienced with Miss J, because Miss J and I were quite close. You know, Andre, the way he was even told he was no longer going to be on the show, I actually said it last Jay's chat. He called me up and he literally left a voicemail saying, ooh, I smell dead raccoons in the river. You know, that was his way of saying, again, the most unprofessional group of producers I've ever worked with, just creating all this kind of weird toxic energy. Andre, this revered editor who should be respected, et cetera, just like Paulina Porizkova, is just kind of trashed and dumped. But beforehand, you know, you just feel this sense that you're about to be shoved out. The same way Miss J was a judge. He didn't know why he wasn't a judge the next moment. They gave him some stupid answer. I remember him coming to me like, what the hell? Then by this cycle, he's literally in like 5 episodes. And they just kind of, they don't even do a real runway teach. Tyra did the real runway teach with you guys. Like, why wasn't Miss J there?
And that was also the only time we saw her.
Yeah, and then that's kind of a weird thing because that's Miss J's thing. Miss J knows exactly what he's doing. And look, Tyra's an incredible runway model. You can't take that from her. But like, why wasn't he there? There was just this now energy of she wanted nothing to do with other people. It was very detached. It was very strange. And everyone felt it.
So do you want to know something that no one knows? So one of my good friends from school went to a university in America and was at school with Tyra's stepdaughter. And I'm sure Tyra like knew this. Not that it should make any difference. But afterwards, we definitely had like some kind of connection. I never heard from her. I heard Allison last week saying that like she'd heard from her and stuff. I'll tell you later what happens after you win. It's wild.
Oh yeah, because there's a question about it. Yeah, we'll talk about it because it happens every cycle. And I want you to describe your experience. And I was there in the judging room. I know exactly how it is, but I want to hear your thoughts around that. We'll get to that at the end, but there's tons of questions here. G Chan Wan said, can you confirm that Sophie was supposed to get brown hair and then she looked to camera because it was in her contract and that's why she got pink hair? Also, there was a rumor that there was supposed to be another British girl and you said, ooh, definitely can talk about this. So interested to know where you heard this. So tell G Chan Wan what happened.
G-Chan won. I'm so excited. I can't sit still. you did, Mr. J. I'm sure if my memory serves me correct, you were like, it's coming short and you're going darker. Do you remember this?
You know, to be honest with you, I don't remember a lot from Makeover Day of this cycle. And I think it was, to be fair, I knew this was my last Makeover Day, my last. And literally, Miss J, myself, you know, we were just told to show up and when. We weren't a part of anything behind the scenes. I used to produce on this show. I wasn't producing a thing, not even the final runway, which we'll get to. Like, I literally showed up on a call sheet and was just told, this is what you're doing. And I just spoke. And it was awful.
Well, it makes
awful.
Sense why the yeah. photo shoots were so odd.
Like... they were crappy. Even the first photo shoot, I felt bad. I had a bad cold too. Oh my God. It was like awful. I had a sinus infection.
Which was the first
on the trampoline.
Oh my God. When I was dressed as Margaret Thatcher, I remember, yeah. and like, Tyra's
with a dodgy
like,
wig.
You will have this in the real world. I was like, I don't think I'll ever have this in the real world. Like,
ever. But back to the makeover, the brown hair. See what happened.
So you said to me, you looked at me, or, you know, it's very high emotion. It's very high emotion all throughout the series. Mm-hmm. I'm sure everyone realizes that. And you looked at me and I'm sure you said, we're going to go short. Now, I was signed to a modeling agency in London. And one of the things.
Oh, I do remember this because you talked about the modeling agency. Okay, you totally jogged my memory.
And,
yes.
And yeah, and I knew what you guys would do. It was going to go short. It was going to go dark, like whatever. And I just got back blonde and all this, blah, blah, blah. So I remember looking down the camera and I was like, I want to talk to a producer. I'll go pink, I'll go cotton candy pink, but you're not cutting it and you're not dyeing it dark. Because, you know, it takes ages for it to get my blonde, which I thought was quite like, quite strong of me at the time. And then you scuttled away and then you came back and we filmed it and you were like, you're going cotton candy pink. And I was like, oh, cool.
Well, at that time, again, everything was so directed by producers. I mean, even the setups, like in early cycles, when the girls would show up in a location, they'd be surprised. Their reaction when they walked in, that was their honest reaction. You guys know what would happen. You'd be shown a room. Here's where you're walking. Here are your marks. Land there. Like, you guys knew. I mean, I would be standing and be like, hey, okay. Then cameras would go on. Then we'd roll for real. Like, by this time, it was such a formulaic mess that nobody knew what to do, because the people trying to piece this together, there are other producers trying to, you know, who were kind of yes people to Tyra and several other producers. And it was just like, whatever. I was like, ugh.
Yeah. Wow, Mr. J, I'm so sorry. I didn't realize that your last one was, I wish you'd ended on a nice, like it was nicer for you.
But I did end on something nice because I really loved you girls. Like I remember even just sitting down and chatting with Annalise the first time going, oh my God, I feel like I know her. Like I went to high school with her, even though I'm like way older than you guys. But yeah, it was like, so.
You literally look way younger than us, by the way.
Yeah, thank you. You guys though made it better for us. So that's what I chose to focus on. It's like, you gotta always look for the silver lining. And I focused on you girls and I really did love your energy and what you guys brought to the table. So that was the cool thing.
So yes, next, makeover, it was definitely, I did say something on that one.
Yes, and then of course, Louise, they played her story, you know, and she was very upset and very emotional, and I get it. And let's just talk in general this season. There was a lot of rebuffing, let's put it that way, if that's even a good word to use. Like people were like, and both the Americans and the Brits were basically turning on production saying, yes, we're done. Because
so
the
did
show
that ever
really
happen
had,
before?
Yeah, well, it had a little bit, but I think, and even from my POV, look, the show had jumped the shark with super smize and capes and nonsense, and it was just so stupid. And it was there, it was no longer about finding America's Next Top Model, which I'm gonna say Tyra came into this with a dream. She really was looking to find that next model and mentor her and bless her for doing this, because it became a global phenomenon. But by this point, it was literally, they tried the high fashion cycle, everything was just now a joke. Mm. I mean, for me, I felt like it was just like, I could see why you girls are like, how's this helping us model? Which leads into the next question, because there's so many about this. So once underscore upon underscore A underscore Sophie, her name is Sophie too, says, thoughts on Asmarie's elimination. She seemed to be doing consistently well. And then she was eliminated out of nowhere for the stupidest thing. Tyra seems to like the idea of androgyny in fashion, in the fashion world, more than she ever likes the androgynous model she actually casts. And Asmarie jumped in. I'm going to read her comment. She just put a teacup. And then MD Tulloch wrote, Asmarie, you were wrongly eliminated. Tyra kept several other people who didn't do challenges or photo shoots. You were my fave. So what were your thoughts around that? Asmarie's elimination. I mean, I'm going to keep my opinion out of it, because Asmarie is like, I don't know. She was like my kindred spirit. Like, I live for Asmarie. She is everything. And still to this day, I follow her on social. We DM and comment all the time. I live for her. But what did you think of her elimination?
So to be honest, as is, Kara is the real deal. She really is. I honestly think she was too good for this cycle. I think she was, she knew her brand. She knew herself. She was so calm and lovely to talk to. And I can't speak for her, but I'm sure, like, she was so level-headed. She was my go-to, like, she's just a dream person. She's really lovely. And what an insanely amazing, stunning look. And to get eliminated on not putting in a butt pad. Like, I was watching it back and I was like, this is insane. This is
And by the way, for those wondering, because there are a lot of questions, because someone also wrote, Joe down the rabbit hole wrote, can you really blame Asmarie for not wanting to do the booty tooch challenge? It was very cringe and not her at all. And what was up? He also says, what was up with the Intoxabella names?
Let me just put it out there. This season was very corny. Okay. This season was definitely aimed at, I don't even know. It sounds like everyone was losing their shit slightly. You know, photo shoots had gone out of whack. You'd gone, basically, internally, the season was probably falling apart. And we were all trying to do our best in pretty much some really ridiculous circumstances.
Absolutely.
And then we would head to judging and we'd be like critiqued on these ridiculous photos. Can you imagine? So, sorry, I just completely I forgot what that question was, but.
Oh no, we were talking about the Asmarie and her booty tooch and the Intoxabella names and all that stuff. But, yeah.
So it's all ridiculous, but you're in this and you're in this weird headspace and you go along with it because quite honestly, you're 20, you're 21. You trust these people. You trust production. You're on one of the biggest shows. The production value is insane. I remember, like, all I wanted to do was talk to the crew, and they held a meeting saying no one could talk to me because I was so interested in behind the scenes. Anyway, but I keep going over.
No, this is good. I can go back to the question. We were talking about Asmarie's elimination, and I think what you were, and I do want to add this, you know, because a lot of people have called it out. And this is the problem, I think, when a show starts to go downhill. And this is where producers didn't think to look at themselves. Mm. Because when the audience can see through the authenticity and they can see through all of this divisiveness, that's why the audience doesn't want to watch anymore. They did not have the foresight to look at themselves as the problem. So they heaped on, as Annalise just wrote down below, cheese, which we had in the previous All-Star Cycle. It was just cheese on cheese on cheese. And no one could face the fact, well, there were some producers, I will say this, absolutely producers who said, guys, you're ruining the show. And they were berated by the producers above them. Because the producers above, kind of malignant narcissists, just don't want to look at themselves as the problem. They just don't. And the show,
this all makes so much sense now, because we were going crazy. Mm-hmm. We really turned, like, not against production, but we scrutinized everything. We were like, they're going to choose this for a bad photo, they want this person out, like, the we came up with every conspiracy theory.
Saw the photo. So by that cycle, I used to even select the photos, then it went to I select the top five. This cycle, I did the shoot. When we were done, I did my interview and I left. I didn't even do a top five mark. They chose whatever they wanted. Oh yeah, and I would see photos. Now remember, I was at the screen, so I saw every photo go by you guys shot. I would sit there and watch and be like, this isn't even near this girl's best shot. But they absolutely, by that point, it was all very strategic. Who was going when? And Asmarie, you were right. Knew her brand, yet they brought on a branding expert that who had ever heard of, who was going to teach everybody about branding. And like the branding was like heaped up, like just up the yin yang that wasn't even like real branding. But Asmarie was the example. You're right. She knew exactly what her brand was.
She's
a phenomenal model. I live for her.
And so kind, super kind. She was so
lovely
solid
person.
In the house. And I think towards the end, I do remember, like, she wasn't, they kept saying full of herself. I don't think she was getting full of herself. I think she was honestly thinking, what on earth am I doing here?
Yes.
Like, you know, we're putting on a fake butt. Like, what the hell has that got to do with
anything? And that's what another, someone else wrote, Glitters0143 was responding to Once Upon a Sophie saying, It's because Tyra hates when girls disagree with her. We've seen that before. And, you know, ultimately, here's the thing. When you've got like this kind of weird pyramid of chaos, right? And it's not just one person at the top, there were a few. When you start challenging authority, what happens in any kind of like weird dictatorship? You got to clamp down, because if you see kind of the masses rising, wow, this almost sounds like the Hunger Games. But when you see the masses rising, right, and you're in the Capitol, what's going to happen? The people, ultimately, they've got to clamp down and show power and authority. And like eliminating Asmarie was just purely an ego-driven thing. It was ridiculous.
It was ridiculous. I don't think they thought, I think they knew the top three. I don't think they wanted it to be me, Annalise, and Laura.
You know, I was never even, I was cut all the way out. I wasn't even privy to conversations of that, where I even heard that. So I can't even speak to that, but I know that they had their sights set on certain people, and there were just rumors that would float around production. I didn't know. You'd hear different people. Like, and we'll get to, one of the questions here was, and I think it is the next question. Okay, yes.
Oh, so this someone's is dirty. Asking about headphones. I'm so sorry. I'll come closer. My boyfriend took my AirPods out of the thing, and I'm actually at a photo shoot today, so I'm just going to shout quite close.
I can hear you. I didn't have any problem with your audio. You know, I don't think it's a big issue. You don't have to be that close. We can hear you, though. So dirty.expensive said, I'm curious about the Ebony Alicia double elimination. When Alicia quit and Tyra also sent Ebony home, did production have a cut have to cut a planned episode due to this double elimination, or was it the amount of episodes set up so that there was always going to be a double elimination at some point, with it conveniently happening here? Absolutely. There was going to be a double elimination. They had done it a few cycles before. We were going to go in cycle 11. It was planned to go from 4 to 2. And that was always the plan in episode 11. But because Alicia, wanted to leave, we ended up doing the double elimination beforehand. But just so, I love that Alicia chimed in and actually answered fans in my feed saying,
oh, did she?
Yeah, she did. So these are Alicia's words I'm reading. She said, thank you. Correct. The key words. Oh, because someone said that they heard that she had been set up to win. So these are Alicia's words. She says, thank you. Correct. The key words, setting me up. That doesn't mean I would have actually won. That just means they were setting it to look like that, or I was told. No one will ever know that for sure. I didn't believe it when I heard it, and I still don't believe it now because it makes no sense. But thank you for actually writing that I said that. So apparently in some blog or something online, she actually commented, oh yes, she wrote here, because someone asked, yes, it's absolutely true. I was told by a producer or crew before going downstairs for the double elimination that I did want to go home. And why wasn't Ebony able to stay? So Alicia knew she was going to leave, and she told producers that before the judging even happened. So what were your thoughts around that day? I remember your reaction being very visible in the show. You were so upset for her that she was quitting, and she was so emotional.
We'd had our ups and downs just because it's such a high pressure cooker. It really is. And when we flew to Hong Kong, we got off that plane. We had a 15-hour flight. Production gave us sleeping tablets to sleep on that flight because they knew that it would be nonstop when we got there. I'd never taken a sleeping tablet in my life. And so when we got there, so we were running on empty. I was done. I remember just before the final, I went up to them and I was like, what do you want from me? I was like, you can't take anything more. You have taken every emotion, like, what do you want from me? So I think with Alicia, she had the craziest journey of up, down. Mm-hmm. And I can't tell you how much that messes on your mind. Like, you know, 1 minute you're getting best photo when you're not. It sounds so silly, but when you're in it, does it completely destroy you?
You're removed from the world. Think of it like a bad dream. Think of it like you're stripped from your world. You've got no phone, no connection to the outside world. You're put in this world that is bizarre. You got cameras in your face. You're not allowed to speak
and
unless you're Mike.
The cameras, unlike Britons, did not turn off until you went to sleep. Oh my God, I have to say this. So when you stay in the hotel for a week, they then randomly, production were like, just get ready, okay? They'd already chosen your like outfit. We got ready. We go on the Universal Walk. Remember that first Universal Walk?
Of course.
We had no idea. We're in the back of a car suddenly. We didn't know we were going to start filming. We'd just been in complete isolation for a week, which now sounds like nothing. But back then, it was quite insane. And we got out, and I remember the producers saying something to all of us like, remember you need to shine, or something about grabbing, say more for airtime. It was something about airtime. And the cameras never turned off until every single person was asleep. So I remember Laura used to be up until 4 a.m. But in your head, you were like, oh my God, I'm losing airtime because the cameras are awake. You know, and you knew they were running around. So you literally didn't sleep. As long as somebody else was asleep, you were doing something because they told you before going in that you needed the airtime. And so that was already bizarre. So when Alicia went, just going back to that, like, I think my heart broke because on camera, but what they edited out, like, this girl was just in like a whirlwind in her brain.
Yes.
And she was doing something selfless by putting Ebony in, and then it didn't work. And like, you know, they messed her over slightly on that one. I don't know. It was just, she had given everything, and she was like, I don't know what you want. Like in photo shoots, like even like that silkworm one or whatever, you know, we were so confused because we might get great feedback from you, and then we go into judging, and it would be like this horrific feedback. Like there was
and that's what happened too, because in previous cycles, obviously I used to select the top 5 photos. Tyra would even read my comments. Oh, well, Mr. J would say blah, 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 blah in judging. That cycle, Tyra didn't read my comments. I didn't, because
that makes so much sense.
Because I didn't give the comments anymore, because quite frankly, no one really gave a shit what I had to say anymore, which was fine, but I did my job.
And we cared a lot.
I know. And so in all I could do really in photo shoots was give you guys the honest feedback. You know, when you guys were great, you were great. When you were slipping, like in your Hello Kitty shoot, when you were doing your little robotic thing, that wasn't your best shoot. But I told you that there, because my job was always to make sure you guys had accurate feedback in the moment. But yeah, it was never brought into judging. Yes, I sat in the final judging and was allowed to give my opinion. But up until that point, yeah, it was like...
Okay, I'm dying to know this. I don't know this. So when we're on... So basically, before we go on stage elimination, I'm sure people have said this, but you're in a holding room. And you are in that bloody holding room, which is the tiniest little room in this whole massive studio. It was like, at the moment...
It's like a teeny little room.
It was literally the size of like this little office. And there was like 12 of us. And I remember I had food poisoning and I was trying to throw up and they wouldn't let me out. And it was like male, you know, because the crew, you think about it, they're a crew, right? This isn't like a fluffy, this is a production. And I remember this crew guy was like, no, get back inside. Like you can't. And I was like, I'm literally going to throw up. And they're like, Tyra needs you on set. And I'm like, I don't know what to say. Like, I'm like,
It's so funny. And Annalise just wrote, it's the size of a shoebox. You know, in my novel, we won't talk about my book today, but in my novel, when the main story takes over, you've got your copy. Yes.
I haven't read it yet, but it came. Yes. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. You're welcome. But when the main story takes over, which is in like the big main story of the book is in chapter 12, I got really short chapters right there. I talk about how the girls are stuffed into what we call the cupboard, this airless room where they can't talk. And that really is really inspired by reality. I always felt horrible for you guys.
But it was just bizarre. And like, you know, and everyone's like, oh, do you get to know Tyra? I'm like, I don't know. We go on set for like, oh, anyway, wait, what were we saying about the, I can't remember what I was saying about the photos, but like, yeah, you go, then you're on set and you literally, it's like, this is the best way I can put it, is everyone's on, apart from Kelly and Knight, but Tyra's like on. Right? Mm-hmm. Like when, and we're not in judging for that long. So people are like, oh, Tyra, I'm like, I don't know anything about her. Like,
yeah. And you know, to be fair, the reason why I wrote my novel is that the real reality show, the real show was behind the scenes. Oh my God. The real show is behind the scenes of that show. What you guys got, what all the fans got to watch on camera, great, fun, crazy. But let me tell y'all a little secret. The real show was all the shit going on behind the scenes.
You need to go live with a producer. I got to hear this. If there's one you still talk to.
I talked to many, actually. I'm probably going to bring in one in my fan episode. We'll save that. But let's keep going because there's tons of questions here. But
okay,
go ahead.
Last one, though. Sorry. So when we went into that holding area waiting to see who got eliminated, what happened? Like, the producers must have been taught, you know, the bit when they film it on their own.
Mm-hmm.
What actually happens there? Because normally it was quite
so
a long
by
time.
Then, do you want to know what really happens there?
Yeah.
You really want to know what happens? That cycle is awful. They literally say, everybody, we need positive and negatives for Sophie. We need positive and negatives for Sophie. So basically, they would just tell the judges, give me a positive and negative on every girl. We'll cut the judging together. So everyone had to give a positive and a negative for each girl. There was no discussion.
So twisted.
They literally, even the final judging, I remember being in there. And I really love, like, I loved you, Laura. Like, I just, all we had to do was give a positive and a negative. So the hard thing was, like, in CoverGirl, I think they aired one of my negatives for you. Because basically, for them to edit a scene that looks like we're having a discussion, you need positive and negatives in a discussion. So basically, we had to come up with negatives even when we didn't have one. They were like, well, give me a negative. So we would just have to come up with a negative.
Wow.
So we had to give positive and negatives, and they spliced the editing.
And it wasn't like that before?
No, earlier on, there were real discussions about who was strong, who was weak, da 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 da. It had become such a machine. Let's bang it out, blah, 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 positive, negatives. And a group of editors and producers decided how it was all going to shape out. Next question. So little Becky Hare says, was there any more tea on the judging with Kelly and Louise's big blow up? And you wrote, ooh, blow. Go ahead. What's the
ooh? Look at me just like getting involved.
What's the ooh?
So I think my opinion on that is Louise was a working model in the UK, right? She was doing commercials. She knew her look. She knew what she was doing. And
she knew, and she was very sure of herself and proven. And that threatens people, right?
Yeah.
You do realize that, right? It's like that saying, shade is only thrown to cover up things that shine. Remember that?
I'm going to get it tattooed.
I should, right? Go ahead.
That makes so much sense because she was very sure of herself. And I guess a lot of us were just playing the part. That is very interesting, Mr. Joe. So my feeling on that is that when Kelly went in, so don't forget, Kelly was very good at talking in sound bites. So Kelly would throw like these kind of funny comments. But when you're in something, and yes, she was like running around on set to get something, but somebody's throwing these sound bites at you, it does come across really abrasive and aggressive because we're British and we're used to people just not really speaking their mind. So I think that contributed to her like having a meltdown and breaking out, and like why she, you on that final interview, that girl was scratching herself. Sorry, on the final elimination, she was so nervous. She was biting her nails. Watch it back. It is wild. She was so nervous, but she knew that she didn't want anyone to speak to her like that. And I think because the television language is so clipped and Kelly was so good at it that she, you know, I can't describe to you how fragile we are in those moments. You don't have your family. You don't have, you know, your
support
other girls
system.
Your friends, but it's competition. Yeah. Like it is. I've never had a mental state like that in my life. It is bizarre. So like, I think everything probably she just exploded and she was like, I can't take this. And I can't.
And
take
I say good for her. I think I probably, you know, I've said this several times in my chats. I would never have wanted to have been a contestant on America's Next Top Model ever, ever, ever. It is forever kind of even tainted, you know, even when I do interviews for other things. You know, I sit down with other producers and I'll be very honest with you. I sit in front of a camera for interviews sometimes and I really worry, like on something that's edited, not live. Live I love because, you know, they can't edit. But, you know, when you sit down to tape something, I'm always second guessing the intention of the producer sitting on the other side of the camera because they know what they're doing. I've learned how to speak in sound bites, obviously years of practice, but still things can be always rearranged to kind of put forth the narrative that somebody else wants. And it's no wonder now that we question reality TV or whatever people are putting out there.
Oh, I watch it all so differently. I can't tell you. I watch The Bachelor. I watch Housewives and I know a few of them and I've been on set in the background. Like I can't, like, yeah. I hadn't realized how manufactured our manipulated season was behind the scenes.
Yes.
I didn't clock that.
Which soundbites, leads into the
said, what are sound bites? They're just quick ways of speaking with
So a negative sound bite would say would be like if you
this
like,
is my top
something
photo.
Kelly would say. So I would say she's a train wreck that looks like a deer in headlights. That's a sound bite because they can use the whole bite, you know. That's what it would mean, even though that's not you. So DW, Dwarfy Mom, I hope I pronounced that correctly, wrote, yeah, I felt that Catherine wasn't edited correctly, to be honest. She had some very fierce modeling pics and a great personality, though through editing, she seemed to never get any credit, and it actually seemed like she couldn't do anything right. What do you think? I love Catherine, and she had some great shots.
Catherine was took an insanely amazing photo. I was watching it back, and I was like, she doesn't have any airtime at all. They didn't give her anything. I noticed
a decision.
That.
Remember, it's all decisions.
Yeah, and she was funny. She got very worried. I remember she worried a lot about things, because don't forget, like, you had no idea what photo shoot you were going into. You'd be kept in a car outside. You'd be set in that bus. Outside, and then exactly what Mr. J said earlier, people have asked me this before. When we go to Tyramella, when we go into a photo shoot, we were always so energetic. We were like, hi! And people are like, what's wrong with you? And we were like, well, because otherwise you had to keep redoing it until you did it, you know, you were. But Catherine,
by the way, that would happen in front of me a lot of the times. You guys would come in and be like, hey, Jay, because you're used to seeing me all the time. And the producers would send you guys out and say, oh, no, we need energy now.
We need energy. So, but Catherine, I have to agree with everyone. I was watching it back and I was like, she doesn't seem to feature that much. And like her music video, when she did all this, was awesome. There was another shot, I can't remember, but like she took a cracking video. So I don't know. That was on production. She was funny.
She was very funny and
very
witty.
Witty,
really witty.
And you didn't see any of that. So I don't know why they didn't, maybe they wanted her to go sooner. I don't know on that one.
Who knows? Again, it's all about decisions and we have to speak about culture. And what I like about this next question is it addresses kind of something that we just spoke about early on, but I think it's Orion, spelled O-R-E-Y-E-N, wrote, recently in an IG post, Instagram post with Nigel Barker, Kelly Catrone mentioned that you were very mean to her on set. She's speaking to me.
Oh.
Was there any tension between the two of you, or is this a misunderstanding? You know, quite frankly, I had nothing against Kelly. I didn't know her before the show. I knew of her, but I didn't know her personally. And actually, since the show, she's invited me to events. I've been at events with her manager where we've all gotten along. And so it's really, it was news to me that she recently, I know she did Nigel's podcast, and it was news to me that she thought I was mean to her on set. And if I came across mean, I apologize. But I have thought about it since I just pulled this question before we went live. And I, you know, again, I look back at the culture of the set, you know, again, a certain producer, senior up, high up, who just won't even mention his name, it's not worth it. His job was always to be divisive. And I know when Kelly was brought in, they wanted more of that tough judge, like a la Janice Dickinson, which I think is smart, you know? And you know, Kelly was a very legitimate PR rep for brands in the industry. I think that's smart too. Mm-hmm. Respect Kelly for all that she's done in the industry. But the first time I met Kelly on set, it was just like, hi, I'm Kelly, blah, 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 blah.
And when I remember was that? When did you first meet her?
Literally when we were shooting.
Which one? Which photo shoot?
I don't think it was even that self-styled shoot. I
the
think
very
we may
one?
Have met before. Anyway, it was somewhere early on, but I can tell you this. I remember what Miss J said to me. Miss J, who was always in the background getting the scoop, and this season he really wasn't even working, so he was just getting all the gossip from everyone. He told me that Kelly was warned. Kelly was warned of me, Miss J, blah, blah, blah. And we were all pitted against each other behind the scenes. It was worse than being the girls on camera. So basically, yes. So literally, Kelly was told, oh, well, Jay's going to be this, and Jay's going to be the one. He used to do the photo shoot, so you're going to do a shoot with him. He's going to try and take control, and blah, 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 blah. That's not the case at all. So this is how.
Why did they want that from you guys? Why would they want it?
Because look, it's all about control. These people, they're like their textbook. I mean, I've sat down and interviewed psychologists for my own book about the characters that they're inspired by. And I know exactly what these types of people do. They literally want to create chaos and dynamic and throw people off so they remain in control. Because you see, if everyone starts getting along, what happens? This person at the top is useless. This little person at the top with a big ego that's easily bruised. We know who he is. The point is, yes, he needs to maintain control. So look, I actually knew of Kelly, thought she was a very important person to bring to the show. I thought she was smart. I had nothing against her. And the next thing I hear recently, I was rude to her. So I'll apologize to Kelly if you thought I was rude. Kelly, I didn't mean to be rude to you. And I have since hung out with you since the show. So hopefully we've got no beef. But I've got no beef with Kelly.
That was the weird thing. I didn't realize you got, like, she was always nice to me, but she definitely singled people out. She had a problem with Annalise being happy and a presenter. Like, she couldn't take Annalise's energy at all. She had a problem with, who was the other one that she, well, obviously Louise. But
can I say something in Kelly's defense? And I don't know. Okay, yes, Kelly was definitely cast to be that strong, opinionated voice, which Kelly did do on camera. But let's remember, who was pulling those strings? Who was feeding her this dialogue to be that person? Because and I just don't think Kelly, just in my own interaction with her, even post the show. Like, again, I've gone to events where I've hung out with Kelly, where she's cool. She's like a cool person. So I just think at the end of the day, we always have to look at what's going on behind the scenes. Because I just don't think Kelly is a nasty person. You can feel her heart. I love how she talks about her kids, her dogs, her this, her that. Like, Kelly's a real human being. And we got to look at some of the toxic people that were shoving and pushing behind the scenes that think they were all that in a bag of chips.
I'm really glad you said that, because I agree. I'm not saying this to suck up. I am 30 years old, right? Okay, like I did this 10 years ago. Like anything I say is just deadly, deadly honest. Kelly invited me to Thanksgiving and I went to her house for Thanksgiving and she was so nice. She was so warm. She was so like kind with her daughter. She had a big heart and she's been through a lot.
She does. Yes.
And I remember on the show being like, she's terrifying. And like, yeah, she had it in for Annalise and this. But outside, and that was Thanksgiving. I didn't know anyone in New York and she invited me into her home. And I didn't speak to, you know, I've seen Nigel at events. He's a doll. I've never seen Tyra.
Miss James?
I'm like, what's her name?
Tyra. Like, ooh, what's her name? Ooh.
Never. Sorry. I was in Singapore at the same event with Tyra and she still wouldn't say hi. And Kelly had, she welcomed me in when I
By the way, that's very, that is very Tyra. I will call that out, you know.
Yeah.
And it comes from a place of odd.
You could have said hi. I knew her stepdaughter really well at the time. Like there was a personal thing there. And
that was, it's her being socially awkward. She doesn't even know what to say to people. I've seen her do that to several people, myself included now. It's just, she's just, when she doesn't know what to say, she just avoids. She's not, she hates confrontation completely.
It's bizarre. I mean, but I had no, I don't know.
You had no reason to, but yeah, it's still strange, right? It's awkward.
Extremely. And I remember hearing Alison last week and she was like, oh yeah, she came to things. And I was like, well, I guess that's interesting and good. But I think Alison had it right. Like if, I don't know. I don't know. I think Tyra.
Well, I think my whole thing ultimately, because we were talking about Kelly, is I have no beef with Kelly. I've seen Kelly since the show. I'm really sad to hear that she feels that she has to say that on a podcast with Nigel, that I was mean to her on set. But I think if we just all look back at what was going on at this time and how things were being manipulated and we were being pit against each other behind the scenes, let's call it for what it is. But you know what? Look, I have no issue with Kelly. I do think she's a lovely person just in my interaction with her post show. So, you know, if I ever see her, I'd be, you know, when Corona goes away, I have no issues with Kelly at all.
So. Wait, somebody's asked something in the comments and I've got to say. So somebody said it looked like you and Tyra are really close. Is that manufactured or was that real?
Meaning me and Tyra.
Yeah.
Me and Tyra. Well, excuse me. Early on in the show and pre-Top Model, we had developed a very, very tight relationship, even when, because she lived on the West Coast. When she'd be on the East Coast working or whatever, she hated being in her hotel. She would stay at my apartment, you know, in my guest room, and we'd hang out. When I would be in LA, or she found out I was in LA doing something else, she's like, what are you doing? You got to come stay at my house. Like, it really was that a long time ago. And it absolutely changed, it, you know, it grew at the beginning of Top Model, because now there was this family and it was intense. It was crazy, but it shifted after Cycle 8, which I've talked about several times on Jay's Chat, because my contract was up. I felt like I could have done all I could do for the show. I was doing other things and I felt the show changing. And so I told her, she asked me, let's never go through our people, meaning agents, lawyers, whatever. Let's always be honest with one another. So I basically said to her, you know, I don't think I can do the show anymore. I don't, my contract's up. I can't renegotiate for more. And they said, and she basically said to me, I'm disappointed, and cut me off. And I understood she was upset. And so I understood it as a human being. I wasn't upset with her. She was allowed to have her emotions around it. And as an adult now, I can look back and see she was upset, like the show was at its height and et cetera. But they, I gave them 3 months to cast other people. They screen tested other people. The network did not like anybody. So they asked me 2 weeks out of Cycle 9 if I would come back, and I said I couldn't. I had an obligation. And then I was essentially threatened through the studio, saying I would never work for the studio again. I just need to come back for one. And I was told that if I came back, everything would be normal. And that producer I spoke with, and everyone called me and said, everything's gonna be normal, normal, normal. And then I showed up, and we were still doing castings then. And I remember, yeah, Tyra wouldn't talk to me unless the cameras were rolling. And I shot a whole season like that. And then our relationship just changed ever since from there.
And that makes you feel like crap. Like,
oh, imagine when they do tape change. You've been on set. We go down for 5-10 minutes a time, and I would get this.
No.
Yeah, literally a back. Yeah.
So bizarre. So you were mentioning last week, you were going to say, and I really want to know this, in our season, so last season they had to refilm the ending, and you said that,
yes.
They, what was that?
Yes. So what happened was, yes, I did talk about that last chat, because the original, and all the fans know this, really, Anjalee was crowned as the winner of the All-Star Cycle. And I love Anjalee. She was not only this great story arc of the girl who kind of came up and pulled herself up by the bootstraps, but she was, I mean, she, incredible bone structure, beautiful heart, worked hard to get where she was. They stripped her of her title for, there are all these rumors. I was never involved as to what the real reason was, because they knew everything about Anjalee and her past, but they basically took the title away from her. Can you imagine, Sophie, after you won, and then they call you a month later and go, oh, we got to talk to you, Sophie. Guess what? You're not the winner. We're gonna reshoot a final judging.
It's so cruel.
What would that do to your spirit?
It would, I would feel so worthless. Like, and it, but not because you should at all, but because that's just a cruel thing to do. You have been through so much and your emotions are like this. And you finally
get home. And then you win
home,
and you can't tell anybody,
and you
remember.
You can't tell anyone, and they pull that on you. That's not nice at all.
And that's what Allison spoke about last week too. And Allison, you know, continues to have a good relationship with Tyra, which is great. But even within that, Allison found that moment awkward, because Allison then was a part of the final judging, which we shot. So I don't know how they convinced Andre. It must have been a contractual thing. But I remember that day. It was awful. And that's why if fans look at the judging set, the act, what aired as the final judging for Cycle 17, if you look at the set, it's actually the set of your cycle with all those big dots on the wall. And we had to kind of get rid of the, you know, the anything that was like British American flag, but we used the same judging room. And I can't remember which day it was, but it was, I think, about 3 or 4 episodes into Cycle 18, somewhere in there. They put it on my schedule. I literally, because I get a call sheet that said I had to be at judging, and I was showing up to reshoot the finale of Cycle 17. Yeah. And I asked them, I said, oh my God, well, are we supposed to wear the same thing? Because I don't have the same clothes. They said, no, 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 we're shooting a brand new judging. You can wear whatever you want. And we showed up and Andre was there, and Andre didn't want to talk to anybody. He was like, let's shoot this and get the fuck out. And because
he's such a talented guy.
He's such a talented guy. But imagine how he was like dumped off the show. And it was really awkward. And it was a very short judging, because now it was just Allison and Lisa brought in. And I felt so sorry for these two girls. And they walk in to reshoot a judging again. And both of them had technically lost. And they're both all-stars. So this is like their third time round with this show, kind of. And they walk in, and the judging was so short. It was just really quick. And I got out of there. It was like the most awkward thing. But we actually taped it after one of your judgings. So it was a day we finished you guys early. And then basically Tyra went back to her dressing room. She changed. Andre and I were in separate dressing rooms. We were brought in like later in the day. So you guys didn't see us. We then shot a whole other judging after one of your judgings.
That is what, and I have to say, so me and Allison lived together in Asia. We lived together in the Philippines for a little bit. And I love her. I've never really, I think I met Lisa on the, she seems really sweet, but like, I was confused because I know they talked about it last week, but I was like, Allison's such a fan favorite. Like, do you have any idea why she didn't win? Why would they not want?
You know, I don't know what the reason was. All I know, again, I was just talent this cycle. And we didn't even know we were going to be reshooting this All-Stars finale. And if you remember, it were for the fans, remember, the way we revealed the All-Stars winner was through that motion editorial for Tyra's Modeland book. And we actually, when we shot that in Greece, we shot all three girls, meaning Anjali, Lisa, and Allison. We shot them all as the winner. They had to reveal themselves with a mask. Uh-huh. So basically, they just had to edit the end of the motion editorial.
Got it.
So when we walked in, they just told us, Lisa's the winner. We're doing this. We're shooting this. Done. Look at your clock. It was like, we were just told Lisa was the winner. That was it. Like, I don't know why. I'd gotten to no discussions with anyone. It was an awful, awful moment to shoot. Like, it was the tension. Like, Andre was angry. Lisa and Alec, like, it was just awful.
Well, it makes sense to why it's interesting why our, I'm so interested to know this, because I knew there was stuff going on, and I knew that production, it did feel like something was off, and the tension just runs down. So we were super tense. You know, and I spent most of that cycle thinking that everyone in production on the panel just hated me, because you could cut that tension with a knife.
With a knife, yeah.
With a knife.
You know, and people have said to me, oh, well, why did you go back after cycle 9 if you were just forced back to do one cycle? Well, then the network came to me and offered me a very lucrative deal to come back, and they negotiate 4 cycles at a time. So, like, you do it, and then when it came to cycles 17 and 18, they wanted me to do 17 through 20, and I said, I can't. So ultimately, I just did 17 and 18. But, you know, I think it's very difficult for people to say, well, why would you go back or not? I mean, at that point, you know, I was back on the show. I was doing it. But, you know, at the end, it was so unfortunate to kind of end something so magnificent that became a global phenomenon on such a negative note. Although, because I knew the last day was my last day, I remember there was a wrap party. And I hadn't really gone to the last few wrap parties for the show, but I actually went, and Tyra actually showed up, because she didn't go to the wrap parties. And I have a photo of like Tyra and I sitting, hanging out, you know, laughing and having fun. So it actually ended somewhat positively. Like, I knew it was the end.
But that's so weird. Like, how can you just be like that with a human being? I don't understand.
Well, I learned to yo-yo with people who are like, I mean, you know, a lot of those people were socially awkward and they didn't know. And I wouldn't say it follows kind of normal human interaction.
I don't mean you at all. I mean, how did Tyra go from like this to you to like this? Like, it's so confusing, right?
So that's a question she has to answer, I guess.
What happens after I win? Do you mind if I say what happens after you win?
Oh no, let's go into that. Well, there are a lot of, like, before we even get to your win, let's talk about, because everybody said, we're talking about this, well, there's a music video we didn't answer. Okay, so here's this one.
Music video,
okay,
so this was is really from fun. Talk about the music video. Music video was super fun. We were so tired, and it was very obvious we only had this studio for like one day. So they had to, you got one take on your shot. Like, that was it. And it wasn't about getting your best shot. They just needed it done. I remember thinking that. I was like, this is just like, I don't know. It just needed to be done quickly. So we were exhausted, and then you basically got one shot to do it. And I think we did all right.
Yeah, and then so and then the other thing is Jean Lazengui. I hope I pronounced your name properly. I'm so sorry if I mispronounced it. But it's G-E-N-E-L-A-Z-E-G-U-I. But said, going from Roberto Cavalli, Versace, Vivienne Westwood, etc. What did Forever 21, the finale runway, feel like? A slap in your face for both of you guys, or were you guys just on a tight budget this season? Actually, I'll let you give your opinion on the runway, but I'll tell you guys, it actually was the opposite. Yes, the show was on a tight budget, but to get to Macau, the tourism board, they paid for all the flights and all
of
that.
I'm sure they did.
And MGM Grand paid a lot for all that MGM
Grand. Did you fly
Grand.
First class?
Well, we always flew first class for the show, but someone else paid for it. And then Forever 21 paid a fortune to do that runway show, whereas the Roberto Cavallis, et cetera, of the world, they didn't pay for placement. We needed Roberto Cavalli. We needed Versace. We were so happy when we did that couture, you know, show in, you know, remember the when we did the couture dresses in Italy? Yeah, but Forever 21 paid for that placement. And this was the runway, again, I had nothing to do with it. I was just told what it was going to be. I thought it was going to be like those cool holographic things that you see, like the presentations that Beyonce does. And yes, you guys did the cool thing with the samurai swords and all of that,
yeah.
But the walking with just the shadow outline was kind of dull. What did you think?
Do you know what? I'm being deadly serious. I was so, this is going to sound ungrateful, it's not meant to. I was so broken at this point.
You just didn't even care.
I couldn't have given, I loved Laura and we were really close on that at the end because we were like, you have to, she was the only person that got it at that point, you know, Annalise as well, but like right in that episode. And do you remember the cover girl? She had like a breakdown.
Of course I remember. I remember it because I felt, at first I thought there was something medically wrong with her, like in terms of like low blood sugar, whatever, but panic attacks are absolutely real. And you know what? You've been talking about this whole live, the pressure cooker of that production, not just only the competition, you know, I felt so much empathy for her, you know, on camera, they show, you know, myself and, you know, Jed, the photographer, walking to a van. That was very real. That was not research. We're like, let's get her to the hospital. Laura Fust, which was one of the, you know, executive producers now on the show, who's a lovely woman. She was just like, we got to get her somewhere. We got to get her. And really, it was Laura, the producer, that said, we've got to get, you know, that read from her at some point. That's why when I came back to your suite afterwards, like a day later when she was feeling better and we actually did her line reads, remember?
Yeah.
We wanted her to have a real opportunity and a real shot at winning. Because we didn't get anything that day, unfortunately. And it was also hot as hell. Do you remember how hot it was?
Yeah, it was so hot. It was all, that was all, madness. But somebody just said something about Simone eating the haggis. Sorry.
Oh, yes. Oh, God.
Yes, she wouldn't share it. And, yes, just watching it. I mean, that is literally what you saw on camera. She just chammed down a whole haggis.
Yeah, which was,
anyway, sorry.
But you were going to talk about, we have more questions, but I do want to get to your experience of winning. So Final Runway, yes.
Oh, the
we
Final
all
Runway.
Realized Final Runway was about money and product placement. Forever 21
Interesting.
Was the placement, and they paid a lot of money for it. And if you imagine what you saw on air was edited and it looked boring, let me tell you, the actual runway show for the audience watching, it was the most dull thing I've ever seen. And not because I had produced the other runway shows for the show. It just was like, who sanctioned this idea? It was so dull.
I really can't remember. I just remember it being me and Laura, and I remember the house felt and everywhere felt so empty. Like everything, yeah. It was bizarre. It was like this one little person I had left. Like it felt like she was my everything. Those days like felt like they took forever. It felt like its own world, just the two of us, like so different.
And before we even get into the win, a bunch of people have written there about go-sees down below. And I will say this.
Oh, yeah.
I was great back in Toronto. So I'm going to talk about some really interesting experiences around that. When I agreed, because we knew when they set the time of the cycle, you know, I had my clothing line in Canada called Attitude J. Manuel, and I knew I had to present at Fashion Week. And so it was always carved out that I was going to leave LA and go to Fashion Week and come back. I had to, because of my contract. And I was showing, it would, like, it was IMG and Mercedes-Benz. It was a huge, just like New York Fashion Week. And you were at my show, you were in my show. It's a huge show, just like New York Fashion Week. And when they told me, oh, we've decided, since you've got to go to Toronto, we're going to do go-sees with Toronto Fashion Week. And it was tied in with IMG, which used to be a part of America's Next Top Model. I was like, really? And you're going to feature my clothing line? Like, is Tyra okay with that? And I was basically told by a producer, we approached her very carefully. She's agreed, because it's many different designers. We'll just say this, just do your thing and just not talk about it when you're on set or speak to her about it. So wow. I never spoke to her about it, but I was really grateful though that they allowed, because it was a great go-see, because it was the first time girls got to actually go-see with, like, pink tartan. You were the only one who walked in the pink tartan show. You guys got to meet real designers and be in a real fashion week, which was cool.
That was cool, because I remember there being loads of other models around. So it was the first time we got to, like, break reality a little bit and actually be outside of this bubble, which was quite nice. I also remember I don't know about the other people when they won their prizes. If they actually got them. I got some of mine. I didn't get some others, which I'll tell you about. But
What did you get?
I did win the trip back to Calgary. I really went to the Calgary Stampede.
Oh, wow.
They really
paid
for everything. Yeah, I think I took my ex-boyfriend, whoever it was at the time. Ebony didn't go. I don't know why. Some kind of conflict or something. But out of my prizes, I didn't get them all.
Oh, really? Okay. Mystery, do you care to share?
Oh yeah. So so after the Forever 21, blah, 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 we go into judging. You were in that judging, right?
Yes. So final judging, we're talking final,
final judging.
Yes, there's, I am there. I
there's
was
so
there,
much.
Yes.
Really quickly, someone said about Kai, and there's so many people that talking. It's really fun. Final judging. So we go in, and I remember they were like, you need to do your last photo shoot with Tyra. And I just started crying. And I was like, I can't do another bloody photo shoot. Like, I was exhausted. I was completely emotionally drained. I was physically drained. My friend the night before just had a panic attack and been sent to hospital. Like, that's a real friendship and a real emotion. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's not that it's about me, but it's just like, it's another thing labeled on, which was just another heap of like shit to deal with. You can't talk to your home. You can't talk to all this. You know what I mean? You couldn't talk to production. You only had, there was one handler, a girl, a lady called Van. You could talk to her. Maybe they loosened up at that point a little bit. But I remember, and it was the first time we could get room service, because you used to have a grocery list and you'd have to buy your own groceries.
Yeah, I was always eating
on the show. And so we go in and they're like, you could do it. And I was just crying at production. And that's when I said to
her. So you did your shoot before, do you guys both shoot with her beforehand?
We both,
or you mean
shot
after the judges?
Before. And it must have been, we were all in our gowns and I was like,
so you both do a quote unquote winner shoot with her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And again, it was very like, you just go in, she stands there, you take a few and out. But I remember I really didn't want to do it, because I was just, I was in such a weird headspace that I felt like it was another competition. Like, I was going to be judged on this as well. And I was just done with being judged. Like, you really couldn't win, right? You had production choosing your photo. And then you got people criticizing a photo that you don't think is very good. Like, it's so, like, how do you, and you know, and
it's a television show.
And of course, and like we did the Macau Tower, and that one up in the Heights was hand on heart to this day the scariest thing I've ever done in my life. Like,
absolutely.
I went back to that hotel and slept for as long as I could until the next photo shoot, because I was shaking and traumatic. And I heard that producers were told by the people at the Macau Tower that it wasn't safe to open it to the public, and they didn't think we should do this shoot. I don't know if that was
because of the rain, because the rain and the wind.
So
absolutely.
Rainy and slippy and windy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. So I'm sure, and I remember, and then if you don't go on, you're gonna lose and blah blah. And I remember you and Nigel were absolute saints that day, and that's when real people come through. Like, really, you both sat with me and, like, gave me a hug afterwards. Like, that was really needed, because that was a real fear of, like, you know, I think you kind of take it for granted and you get judged and they're like, well, I've had to do things in my judging day. And I was like, okay, maybe if somebody offered me a lot of money, I'd probably do it. But more or less, like, that is not something I would do day to day. So it's hard then when you've just gone through something and you're being criticized and they're
so
like,
you have your,
well,
you have your winner shoot with Tyra, oh, and now it's the final judging. Because they're asking about the final judging, and we still have to hit the focus group thing because I'm reading everyone's comments down below. But
I'll
please do final judging and tell us your experience of how it happens and how it ends.
So we went in, we did the final photo shoot. We then go into, Tyra asked me something like why I should win top model, right? And mm-hmm. I completely froze. I couldn't think of anything. My confidence level was down here. I don't know what happened. I just stood there and I couldn't think of one thing to say. And Laura had just given her spiel and it was really good. And it was from the heart, I deserve this. And I think I ended up just being like, I just want to win or something. It was ridiculous. And later on, producers had told me that I almost didn't win because of that, like, because I couldn't.
Because of that answer.
Because of that answer. Mm-hmm. I couldn't, like, mm-hmm. say why I wanted to win because I was just mm-hmm. so gone at that point. So we came back on. I remember I, hand on heart, I was like, I haven't got this. After that, and, like, the judges were looking at me like, were you in that? I can't remember if you were there.
Of course, yeah. No, I'm in the final judging.
You're in the final judging. Yeah, sorry. I haven't quite got to it. I'm literally on the last episode. I was watching
that. Yes, I'm sitting right there, yeah.
So you're there, and, like, and I remember just, and all, you guys were all looking at me as if to be like, you really can't, like, shit, you just need to say one thing, girl. So then we leave, and I remember I said to Laura, I was like, you've got this. And I think maybe she might have thought as well, because I really screwed it up. And I don't think they ever aired it. I don't think they aired that bit. But she was like, you've got this, you've got this. So my reaction when I won was pure, like, what on earth? I also didn't realize that you won money. I thought they said you win a contract worth this much. So I was like, Kelly was like, what are you going to do with the money? And I was like, what money? And they were like, you win the $100,000, which you kind of do. You get taxed on it and it takes a while. So you don't quite win $100,000, but, like,
yes.
You know. And I remember
anything in this country you get taxed on.
You get, so this is what happens. You win, right? You're like, oh my God, amazing. Two cameras go off. You look around. The set is coming down. The set
literally
is being taken down. Everyone's gone. I think, like, you guys gave me a hug. Everyone is just gone. It is quiet. Your handler takes you back to a hotel room. I wasn't allowed to talk to Laura. Oh, no, sorry. Before that, as soon as I win, the producer comes with a huge contract about this thick and puts it down. It's like, you can't tell anyone, sign this contract. Mm-hmm. So you sign a contract and you're like, you know, you're on cloud nine. You're like, I've just won. We've been doing 2 months
before.
I'm then in a hotel room completely alone. I remember, I think I figured out how to find Laura and we were just, like, huddled together. We were told when our flights were. Laura, I think my flight was 6 hours after winning. So literally, you don't know any of this. You have no idea mm-hmm. what's going to happen. So suddenly I'm in a hotel room, like, on my own. I've got a flight in 6 hours. I get on this flight and I'm
you
back.
You can't tell anybody. And that's it. And you can't tell anyone.
You can't tell anyone. And then you're just back in the UK. And I've got to say, like,
it's very anticlimactic. You get thrown up and then it's just like, douche, drop back,
like,
into your life.
Now, it is the weirdest feeling, and I'm suddenly home, and I don't know what to do. I've just been with people solidly for 2 months. No one, you do not have a moment. You are escorted to the toilet to make sure that you don't talk about things. Van used to walk us to the toilet. She went alone for 2 months, and suddenly that was it. You don't hear from production. Maybe I must have been, like, texting with the girls, I'm not sure, but I remember I didn't know what to do. For, like, 3 months, I just stayed home, like, just purely confused. And I thought there'd be a lot more, maybe, aftercare, and you don't. And you guys, I would guess, well, you'd left,
nothing.
But they'd start on the next season. You know, I think they want you to do, this is really bad, I don't know if I should say this, but, like, they want you to do well after, because I think they just want the title to stay current.
Of course.
And mm-hmm. What prize didn't I get? Yeah, so the money, did come, I think, come through, and I moved to America. So obviously that's all very expensive. I had to get a visa. So it took ages to get a visa. I think I had a contract with Forever 21. I don't know if you guys remember the prizes. I don't mm-hmm. think I got that. I never got the Forever 21 thing. I was meant to be a TV.
Which you would have been perfect for.
Which would have been, maybe I did, like, one thing with, I can't remember, but I basically, I went to Coachella and hosted one thing for them, but I'm sure I was meant to do a campaign and stuff, and it didn't happen. I was meant to host for Extra, and they only gave me one of those segments. And, like, I had agents at the time. So I was, like, chasing these prizes because I really wanted to do TV presenting. My parents both work in television. Like I never really thought that I was like
that. It's interesting that you say chasing because that's what a lot of girls have experienced. What happened really? With the fragrance?
I don't know. Did that ever come out?
Exactly.
The fragrance didn't. And I'm trying to think what the other. So it's the Vogue Italia came out. We'd already shot that. I was living in London, and the guy, the music video guy, I don't know if you remember, who was with Lisa, he flew to my house for 24 hours to write the song, which we wrote together. And I was like, I don't know if you ever heard my song. It's like, we're aiming for you. So yeah. I begged producers to let me not release the song because I was like, this is ridiculous. I'm not a singer. Like, I really can't sing. I can't dance. Like, what on earth am I doing? They were like, you have to. I wrote this song, we sent it back, and it's like 8 hours behind is LA time. So we're waiting. We get notes back. You need to say Smize, Pot Leadem,
Booty. And where do you think that came from?
And I was like,
Smize, Pot Leadem, Booty Chooch.
I quite like this song. Oh. And I remember just saying to this guy, I was like, I'm living in a mallet house. Like, what's going on? And so I think we incorporated it. And I get what she was doing. She was pushing the brand. She's so clever at what she does. I think she'd got to a place in our cycle that everyone had just lost it. Like, you know what I mean? It was all just so...
They were
so like,
drinking a serious Kool-Aid.
It was, yeah. So I didn't release the song, but at the beginning, it's really odd because I'm like, it's like, you know, it has all these strange words in and blah, blah, blah. But apart from that, you don't... To be fair, the main producer, to be fair to him, was really kind to me and got me auditions after.
Oh, he that's nice to hear a positive story.
He actually sent me for a CW network and he was like, you should do acting, which weirdly I've started doing classes now. Mr. J, I can't tell you, I was so broken. My confidence took years. And I don't think it was necessarily, it wasn't like the show or anything. It was the fact that, you know, you're up here, but then you're in the real world, and like, it wasn't reality TV when I did it, wasn't really accepted. Instagram wasn't a thing. It was just happening. So like people, the agencies didn't quite know what to do with us. It was just a weird time. Do you know what I mean? So like, and also, by the way, sorry, this is coming across like, it was so much fun. And I don't mean that all my confidence was shot because of the show. I just mean, I'm a very delicate person. So I think,
but no, I think a lot of the girls have said that, and I think it's a journey, and you got to learn from it. I'm hoping that ultimately it has given you like this strength that I know you have today. I mean, you've got like this amazing confidence, the way you're out there working, the way you represent yourself now. But it, you know, with all of us, you know, things that don't break you make you stronger.
It's true. And
ultimately,
it's sounding, I had such a blast filming it. So this is all sounding, I think it was more like afterwards going into the, I don't know. I also had my own personal problems. Like, so this really isn't at the show. Cause when I watched the show back last night, I was like, my God, this was so much fun. Like, I'm so lucky. This was a blast. Like, we did silly things where we were like running around with like, we did so much stuff off camera to have fun. And I really did have a blast. So like, that's all coming. I'm not being like a whiny, like, oh my God, it was really hot.
I think you sound whiny at all. I think what you've described accurately describes the insanity, you know, kind of behind the scenes and that energy, which affected everyone and a lot of producers as well. And I know them, a lot of them have gone to therapy. Like I said, after cycle 18, a lot of people left this show from behind the scenes. They were done.
Whoa.
Yeah. So
it's very different. I think the cultures and, you know, the American, I don't know, but it seemed like a strange thing at the time. It seemed weird that us Brits were here. Like, you know what I mean? The whole thing was just like, was just off.
And you know, and it's interesting. So, and some people have said, well, why am I doing the Jay's Chats now? Why am I talking about it now? Well, actually I can talk about it now. And everybody should have an opportunity to share their truth. Again, my novel is only inspired by this world. It is a world, my book is a world of fiction, but it is rooted in some kind of my own truths and to give a sense of authenticity. Because what I was saying earlier on is the show started to go down when the audience started to see through it. And if you're, you know,
you
if it's
confused.
No longer...
They didn't know whether we were meant to be a reality show. I think the Kardashians were coming up. Oh my God, we did the first shoot with the Kardashians where I have to say they were
with
all...
Kris Jenner.
With Kris Jenner, you know, who was amazing.
And
like
Kendall.
Stunning.
And yeah.
And then later on, I actually went to the Philippines with Kylie before she, like, you know, looked new,
looked like Kim.
Just looked like Kim, and she was an interesting character. But we did meet these amazing. The focus group. Somebody was going to say. So the focus group, I remember this really well. We all went on. Kyle like messed up. People messed up. Now the focus group was very white, and it was. Mm-hmm. And I didn't really realize this, like, at the time, privilege, like, you know what I mean? Like, I have a lot of empathy for everyone, but I don't think I realized. So afterwards, like, Alicia and, you know, and I think maybe Ebony and Smurt, they were very vocal about, like, this feels like a direct attack. And one of the focus groups said about Alicia in, on, you know, and they played it, which was, we don't like her African accent.
Her African accent. Which was a snapshot. That was a real focus group.
Those were not actors.
And I understand in theory what that would do to ultimately try and help the girls, but it also was an interesting portrait of America and kind of how they looked and viewed, you know, people of color. You know, I know even in myself, and I was already on TV and I was up for another job. And I remember my agent coming back to me and they're like, oh, you know, he's too E, because I was on E for several years. I was like, well, what does that mean? And then finally came back with, well, we're not looking for a person of color right now. You know, it's just like, that's how the industry is, you know, unfortunately.
But they didn't play that much of it, because Alicia was really upset, and like Miss J was really incredible in that time.
Yeah, Miss J was incredible in that moment. Yeah, he was just like, girl, you got to get it together. This is what the world is.
And it was true. And I think, and that rattled those girls for a while.
Yeah,
that really did rattle everyone. Of course it did. You had to hear that from a group that, like, this all kind of white group who would just, and I remember, but they liked Kyle because she was very girl next door and white. And I think that's where this, and Kyle was kind of like, oh, shut up guys, like, get your stuff to, you know, I can't, I've said that, like, forgive me. But I think she was a bit like, you know, oh, and that caused more friction. I think in the house, that's where that all started to crumble.
Yeah. Oh my God, this, do you know we've been going for like an hour and a half?
And I could go even know, for like
you only get
hours.
So much to push up into the IG cloud. So what I'm going to do, I'll probably have to wrap it here, because I don't want them to cut me off. It's been like 90 minutes almost. And I think there's a cutoff in like a couple of minutes. So I don't want to lose this chat. Sophie, you and I, as soon as we can get Miss Corona, like, you, we've got to get together for dinner. I'd love to hang with Eric. Because I love Eric as well. I know you and him are friends.
Yes.
Let's get together. I love your energy. This has felt like the best catch up, because first of all, it felt like 5 minutes. And it's like, I'm just hanging with an old friend. And like I said, this cast of girls, I loved hanging with you guys so much, shooting that last cycle with me. So you guys were the silver lining of the show for me on this last cycle. So thank you so much. Thank you, genuinely.
No, that makes me, I have to say, A, thank you for saying that. B, thank you for doing all these chats. They have been incredible. And I think it is good that people, it's not bitching, it's not slander, it's nothing like that. It's just stuff
that
happened.
It's like, these things happen, these are true.
Yeah, it was 24 hours for 2 months. Like, you know, it's a wild time. And you look amazing. Whatever your
business
is, I think you need to like.
Thank you.
But
thank
I
you
also
so
have to say thank. Annalise is in the chat, and just the biggest love to Annalise. She is
awesome. Thank you guys so much for being here. Thanks everyone for being here. And I am gonna do one more America's Next Top Model Jay's chat with fans, where I'm gonna connect with multiple fans over the course of like 80 minutes. I'm going to try and get as many people. So instead of reading questions, I'm going to connect you all down below. I'm going to answer you guys face to face. So I am going to announce that next week, but I'm going to do a fans America's Next Top Model Jay's chat, where I get to talk to everyone face to face.
But thank you. Thank you also for being so honest and kind and real in that experience. I had no idea what you were going through, and you were a rock to us. So that's really commendable, because I couldn't imagine we were going through physical torture. I couldn't imagine as an adult knowing, you know, being the strong person you, I couldn't imagine what that was like.
Yeah. We'll talk more offline. I'll give you some more tea, because before Instagram cuts me off.
Okay.
Thank you, Sophie. Thank you,
you
guys so much. We'll see you all real, real, real soon with the fans Jay's chat, the final one, the fans one. Okay, bye.
Bye.